Well, we have inevitably been looking at the potential of DCE. So we're going to come right back down to earth now with insight into how data centricity has been applied during the COVID-19 pandemic. Dr. Nuria Oliver joins us from Spain with a case study of how science, supported by AI, has directly impacted the people of Valencia by assisting their government with decision-making during the past 18 months. Hello there, Nuria.
Hello, I'm Nuria Oliver, and I'm going to be sharing with you the experience that we've had since March of 2020 using data science and AI to fight against COVID-19 in the Valencian region of Spain. The main purpose for our work has been to assist in better decision-making during the pandemic through the analysis of data. And to do that, I have been leading a team of over 20 scientists from different universities and research centers in the Valencian region of Spain, which is located on the east of Spain. We are called the Data Science for COVID-19 team, working directly for the president of the region. And our main purpose is to fill the gap that there is between where the data is and where the policymakers are. Ideally, the decisions that the policymakers make are based on evidence. And if data is a digital representation of an underlying reality, what we would like to do is to be able to draw insights from the data that are reflective of such a reality so they can inform the decisions that the policymakers make. Traditionally, it's been very hard to fill this gap. In the context of the pandemic, we have structured our work into four large work streams. The first one is human mobility analysis, because an infectious disease that is transmitted from human to human, like coronavirus, doesn't become a pandemic if people don't move. So modeling and understanding human mobility is very important. The second work stream is focused around computational epidemiological models, models that would enable us to predict the pandemic curve, not only under the current situation, but under different potential scenarios of intervention measures. The third area is building predictive models, mainly of hospital occupancy, intensive care occupancy, and the prevalence of coronavirus. And the last area is a very large-scale citizen survey called the COVID-19 Impact Survey. It has over 600,000 answers in the world and is one of the largest to date to understand people's situation and perception during the pandemic. But even the work of all these different teams is still quite technical, and there is a gap between that work and where the policymakers are. And I think one of the key elements for the success of our team is this sort of like beige layer here of aggregating the results, interpreting the results, preparing them, and translating into actionable insights that can be used by the policymakers. And one key element is that a director general working for the president or public policymaker has been and is a member of our team, coming to every meeting and doing this exercise of translating the results into understandable language for the politicians. There are many challenges about creating such a team, and we actually reflect on a lot of these challenges in this paper that we published in April of 2020 in Science Advances. A very important challenge is the lack of capacity, awareness, and digital mindset in many governments and public administrations. There are many challenges around accessing the data and, of course, concerns about privacy and data protection, even though I want to highlight that all the work that we have done and I will present today has been done using anonymized, large-scale, aggregated, non-personal data. There is also a gap between when research ends and where sort of like the real world starts, and bridging that gap is not easy. And of course, in the context of the pandemic, when decisions need to be made very quickly, if we don't have all these elements in place, it's just very difficult to be able to leverage them. And perhaps because we've been able to do this for so many months, that's why our team has received a certain amount of international visibility. We've been featured in Politico, in MSNBC, or in Wired recently. So what have we done? I don't have the time to go into detail, but I just wanted to give you a brief overview of some of the results of each of the areas. In the mobility analysis area, we have been able to analyze large-scale mobile data that has been derived from the mobile network infrastructure through a collaboration with the National Office of Statistics in Spain. which in turn had a collaboration with the three largest telcos of Spain. So since March of 2020, we have been able to analyze the mobility flows in the Valencian region of Spain. And we found that during the first and hardest confinement in the spring of 2020, the impact of the confinement measures on the mobility was very significant. There was a significant reduction in the radius of gyration of 65%. The stay at home campaign was very successful with 88% of the population in working days or 92% in weekends staying in their area of residence and not leaving. In terms of labor mobility, the impact was also very large. On average, we found that there were 60% fewer people outside of their area of residence during working hours when compared to a reference day in November. And we also analyzed the activity levels in the different areas of the Valencian region, and we found that they were also significantly lower than before the pandemic. To ease the understanding of all this data, we built some visualizations that are publicly available and that the policymakers could use, where they could select each municipality and look at the incoming flows, outgoing flows, activity levels, changes in activity levels, success of the stay-at-home campaign, and so forth. Because we have the mobility flows, we can also run community detection algorithms to identify communities of mobility. And this is very important because we can identify self-contained regions that could be useful to identify areas where to do partial confinements. For example, in the Valencian region, we identify 14 self-contained geographic regions. The second working stream has been based on building computational epidemiological models. And we have built three types of models. The first one is a traditional metapopulation SAIR model, where the population is divided into four states, like the SAIR acronym says, S for susceptible, E for exposed, I for infected, and R for recovered. And there are different probabilities that determine the probability of a person to move from being susceptible to being exposed, from being exposed to being infected, and so forth. Such probabilities have been estimated for coronavirus. And since March of 2020, we have developed a model that has been adjusted to the Valencian region and that also includes the mobility that we have from the, that I just explained from the other work stream. And we've been building predictions, daily predictions on the number of cases and active cases in the region and each of the provinces every day. We have also built an agent-based model. In this case, the model captures the behavior of every individual in the region, in our case, 5 million people. And each of them can also be in four states, like the SAIR model. And then you can run simulations with this model and determine how the pandemic would evolve under different scenarios. And we've also been building predictions every day. And finally, in the fall of 2020, we decided to participate in the XPRIZE Pandemic Response Challenge, which was a global challenge to organize by the XPRIZE Foundation and sponsored by Cognizant to use AI to help fight COVID-19. The challenge entailed two really big tasks. The first one was building a predictor of COVID-19 infections. And in our case, we decided to use deep neural networks to predict the number of COVID-19 cases in 236 regions and countries in the world up to 6 months into the future, and taking into account the different interventions implemented by each of the countries and regions. To do that, we had two different streams of recurrent neural networks, LSTMs, one to model the interventions, which we call actions in the bottom, and one to model the number of cases, and to allow the flexibility to model every country in the world, we developed a bank of LSTMs that we obtained by clustering the different countries in the world based on the dynamics of the number of COVID-19 cases. Our predictor actually worked really well in terms of the competition. I think it was ranked third worldwide in terms of mean rank and first in all the European and Asian countries. But more importantly, we were able to use this model during the third wave of infections in the Valencian region, which took place right after Christmas and which was the worst wave of infections. And the model was extremely accurate, both in predicting the day of the peak of infections and the number of infections in the peak. As you can see here in the blue line, these are the predictions from our model. And the yellow line is the actual real number of cases. Moreover, With these results, we went into the final of the Express competition. And in the final, what we had to do was add another layer here in our graph, building a prescriptor of interventions or a recommender of interventions that policymakers could use. This recommender of interventions had to have the best trade-off between the cost of the different interventions and the number of cases that would yield. And we had to provide up to 10 different policies of interventions because, of course, different countries and different politicians might be willing to accept different kinds of costs. This is what is called identifying the solutions that are on the Pareto front of a two-dimensional space, where in one axis we have the number of cases and in another axis we have the cost of implementing such interventions. We developed different methods to be able to come up with the Pareto front of interventions, and we also built some intuitive visualizations so policymakers could use them. And this was the final phase of the competition. And in March of 2021, XPRIZE announced the winners, and it turns out that we were the winning team in the competition. So that really made us really happy. And it was really the first time that a Spanish team won an XPRIZE competition. The third area is focused on building predictive models, and we've been building lots of models of incidents and deaths and intensive care occupancy and hospital occupancy in each department of health in the Valencian region. There are 24, and we've been using neural networks to do that as well. And finally, to understand people's situation and perception during the pandemic, we deployed a really large-scale survey called the COVID-19 Impact Survey, which has enabled us to answer questions such as, what is the emotional impact of the pandemic? What's the prevalence of symptoms? Are there enough tests or not? What kind of social contact behavior do people have? What kind of individual protection measures do they take, and so forth? The survey is being deployed in many different languages, and we have a really significant sample from Spain, Italy, Germany, and Brazil. We have over 600,000 answers, and we have been able to publish a number of papers sharing the results, and I encourage you to read them if you are interested. This is a very early paper that we published in JAMIR in 2020. We've also built some intuitive visualizations, and the most up-to-date is this one here in Tableau. And we have two upcoming papers, one that will be published in Nature Scientific Reports really shortly, and another one that we're also working on it, analyzing some of the questions from the survey. So what have I learned after all these months working on fighting COVID-19 using data and AI? So the most important learning, I think, is a learning that we all know, which is a pandemic is not just a public health challenge. It is a societal challenge, and it requires a holistic approach to tackle it. And in particular, I think we have a huge opportunity to create a virtuous cycle between three elements, which we haven't really been successful in doing. First of all, high quality data that is systematically captured and analyzed and shared that enables us to understand where we are, why we are where we are, and where we might be going. Secondly, investments in the necessary human resources and technology. So these human resources, you know, researchers and doctors and social personnel and contact tracers and teachers, you know, they have the right tools to actually do their job efficiently. And finally, all of these should be done to identify weaknesses in the system and deploy public policies that tackle such weaknesses. For example, from our data, we know that it is the youth, the ones that are carrying the biggest psychological burden of the pandemic. So let's deploy programs to support the youth. We also know that roughly only 50% of the people age 59 and younger can self-isolate if they need to because of COVID-19. So let's provide isolation infrastructure and so forth. We reflect on all these issues in this publicly available paper that I co-wrote together with the Vodafone Institute and Data Pop Alliance. And if you are interested in knowing more about our work, we have a lot of publications, scientific publications, but also, as I mentioned, we have some more high-level publication in Wire from a few days ago that explains our story. And just coincidentally, on September 16th, during the ECML-PKDD conference, we will be presenting our paper, which has won Best Paper Award in the data science category. Thank you very much.